Shut up and sit down.
And welcome to the week 6 edition of the Black Swarm podcast. Hank Piper here with Rob Antonell. Can't believe it's already halfway through the season, but here we are. And got a lot of feedback from last week's episode. People were indeed saying they like it shorter, so we'll try and speed run this as best as possible and not ramble incoherently like we're used to. So with that, let's get into it. Big win over Eds. What, 31-21 up in what, you know, we can best describe as their house because they really don't have a house. So, Rob, let's get into it. What'd you think of the game?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, anytime you can come out of there with a win or playing anywhere against a team like St. Ed's and you get a win, and that's obviously a good game. So, you know, I think we did exactly what we needed to do. At the time, I didn't realize just quite how good our defense played. You know, I knew that Ed's was having a hard time getting anything going. They weren't really sustaining drives. They did hit us with a few big plays. Got some help from the refs, but you know, their actual rushing yards for the game were abysmal. And, you know, we were talking about how the defensive line and our offensive line, you know, needed to step up. And, you know, in a game that's decided in the trenches, you know, Massillon came away with decidedly better results on both sides of that.
Yeah. I mean, I knew, like, in the game, it was they were having a hard time running the ball, but it wasn't until, like, seeing the numbers at the very end that it was, like, jarring. 30-something carries for like 51, 52 yards on the ground they had. And I mean, we had, you know, a very hard time running the ball ourselves, but I think we found a little bit more success here and there in spurts. Obviously, their passing yards looked a little bit better, but a lot of that was helped out at the end just from us playing more of a prevent and them trying to hurry up, you know, get down the field. But yeah, I was as equally surprised how our defense played because, honestly, going into it, it was like, I know Eds wasn't Burgeon Catholic, but when in the second half of that game, when they decided they were going to run the ball and we couldn't do much, you know, I was a little bit worried going into it. But our defense bucked up, they came out, they showed out, and I mean, yeah, the results speak for themselves, I guess. You know, the refs, it always sucks having to talk about the refs after a game like this. It's nice, you know, getting that one out, like coming out of that with a win, because obviously you sound a little bit more bitter and jaded. So when you can talk about the refs after a win like that, I think it's easier to come across as a little more genuine and not looking for excuses. But they were absolutely abysmal. I mean, I think anyone like objectively watching that game can say it was like homering the entire time. What was the stat you gave of Ed's penalty yards versus the opponents?
I mean, I could look it up, but it was something insane. And, you know, it was like going into the game, St. Ed's, yeah, probably just be easier if I read it. So you keep talking while I find it.
Yeah, I mean, there were, you know they're getting bad when it's like every fourth and short measurement, all the fans are yelling, don't let him touch the ball, don't let him touch the ball, he's going to move it, don't let him move it, and like just holding your breath anytime you get a big play that, you know, you're waiting for that laundry to come out. It was that big when the 3rd and 10 right after Slaughter had like an 18-yard scramble to get us into like manageable down distance for that third down, when we just called 4 verts and our number 2 had the guy like 3 steps on the defender, and it, you know, it looked like the defender just full extension pushed him and just eyes shot right to the ref staring it down, and he just waves incomplete and no flag comes out. It was bad. And I think it was like, you could tell it was going to be really bad right after Big Mike got it was either a sack or a big tackle for loss in the backfield. And he does what is a Fortnite dance, you know, a video game for kids. He does a dance off of that. Yes, I know it looks like a gun, but he had it pointed in a safe direction and finger off the trigger. He's practicing gun safety, and I think we should encourage that and not punish it. But you knew it was going to be bad pretty much from the get-go.
Yeah, I mean, I understand it, You know, some of our personal fouls are still bad. You know, I think we had three in the first half. I'm not sure if we had any in the second half. But, I mean, after the touchdown run, Gamble did get, like, in the kid's face, bent over top of him and started talking crap. And it's like, that's going to be a penalty.
Yeah.
Right? In a game like that, you score a touchdown, personal fouls don't really kill you. Sometimes celebrating touchdowns, this is what it is. But then, yeah, I mean, Big Mike sack. And then he did kind of a little bit of a celebration after the sack. And then carried that into doing his machine gun movements. And it's like, it's a flag. You can't do that in the wide open, right? In the NFL, they zoom in on the guy that got a sack, and they let you do a 30-second routine. But this isn't the NFL. It's high school, and you can't do that. Especially, you can't do machine gun movements. You can call it a Fortnite dance, but a guy's holding a machine gun on his hips. And, like, you know, that came out way before Fortnite did. And, you know, you just can't do that. And then I think we had a late hit that was, you know, ticky-tacky, maybe. I don't remember exactly what it was. But
yeah,
here's the stat about the penalties. So going into that game, St. Ed's had 17 penalties for 175 yards, whereas St. Ed's opponents had 40 penalties for 350 yards. Now, going into that game, Massillon had 44 penalties for 400 yards. And Massillon's opponents had 29 penalties for 192 yards. So Massillon, who is a very highly penalized team and don't receive very many penalties, is going against Heads, who does not commit very many penalties and is very good at drawing a lot of penalties. So, I mean, that kind of carries over. But, again, the refs were not good. There's some calls that were just blatantly incorrect. But still, you know, some of that stuff is still on us. You still got to, you know, control your emotions. And I know that was a talking point going into the game. But, you know, we came away with the win, but there's still a lot of things that we can clean up. There's still things operationally that we can clean up. There's a few plays that I'm sure we want to, you know, correct. And, you know, just... There's still room for improvement, but you knocked off the three-time defending Division I state champ, the number one ranked team in the state, and anytime you can do that, it is always a good thing.
Yeah, and okay, if I'm gonna like drop character for a second, the machine gun dance was bad. You can't do that shit. But at the same time, it's a game. In some way, like, let the kids have fun. I know these are like all, you know, geriatric referees that have a stick up their ass, like, oh, everybody needs to be professional and shut. It's a game. Let them have fun. Machine gun dance, not great. Probably should, like, not whip that one out. Keep that one in the back pocket for practice or a scrimmage or some shit when it doesn't matter. But there were a bunch of things that the refs didn't call either. Like, so the one late hit out of bounds, you know, that one I thought was extremely ticky-tack, and it looked even worse when we got the ball back and we had a kid hit pretty solidly laid out of bounds and no flag came out. You know, there was, I think they were holding all night and never got a flag called on that shit.
Yeah.
So, like, that's the stuff. It's when you see the obvious stuff and they're not throwing the flag on it is tough. But it is what it is, and that's just being Massillon, being... playing at St. Ed's, it's something you got to deal with. Yeah, the play calling. I never like to get too critical of what plays you do or don't call, just because it's hard to, you know, how to look in practice, what you're feeling in the game, what you do and don't have on the call sheet. But there's certain things, like, I understand you're kind of setting up the end around pass where you run the motion once on a run play and then you come back to it. That whole thing just looked, you know, not great from the get-go. You respect tolls trying to get rid of the ball, but at the same time, you have to know that if you're not the guy that took the snap, you can't throw the ball away. It's either throw it or run it. The, you know, third and short deep bomb, that was one where, in my own head, just being the weirdo I am, it's like, okay, what would I call here? And my thought was like, oh, play action bomb would be sweet. So then my immediate thought after that is like, well, I thought it, so that's fucking stupid. I hope we don't do it. And we did it.
I obviously didn't like that call. And, you know, if it would have worked, great. But it just seemed like they always had a high safety that was back there. You know, they never really dropped him down where we were just running past him. Not that we really tried to run, you know, a whole lot of deep balls, but they just always had a safety deep. Or at least it seemed like it to me when they were doing that. And, you know, it's third and one. Even if you don't get it, you're taking 40, 50 seconds off the clock when there was like 3 minutes and 45 seconds left in the game. So, you know, sometimes being conservative, it works. You know, obviously our defense is really good and it got us the ball back and it didn't end up mattering. You know, we essentially got that first down, but killed an extra minute off the clock by doing it, by getting the ball back ahead of where the first down marker was anyway. But, you know, it's you know, trying to go for hero ball against a really good team. And, you know, sometimes this, the easy way, the conservative way is the smart way. Don't overthink it. You know, kill the clock, punt the ball, and, you know, do what you got to do. Or, you know, convert. You know, obviously the next drive we weren't afraid to go for. We went for it on fourth and longer. And, you know, we didn't even think about it. It was just like, hey, we're going to go for it right here.
Yeah. I mean, like you said, the defense, they were playing back. They were sticking with two high pretty much the entire time against that particular set we had, with the safeties playing deeper than I, you know, you would figure for a heavy set like that. So it's one of those things, if you make it, you know, if we convert, it's a genius play. It would, obviously, when it doesn't, it's a talking point. But yeah, we were super aggressive on fourth down. I think we finished the game 3-for-3 on fourth down, which is astoundingly good. I think it was earlier in the game where we had that 4th and 5 going down into the end zone, and we must have saw something in their defense, because there was not, I don't think there was a soul on our side of the field that thought we were actually going for it, you know, up in the stands. It was like, okay, all right, we're motioning the wing. We're just trying to draw them off sides. Oh, shit, we snapped it. Mm-hmm. Oh, shit, we're running it. Oh, shit, we got it.
Yeah, I think that's one where the defense wasn't expecting us to go for it either. So, you know, when our lineman fired off the ball, I don't know if the defense is ready for it.
Yeah, I mean, whatever it was that either we saw, that, you know, they saw, or just kind of playing that I know what you know what I know game where the defense thinks we're not going to go for it. I mean, it worked. And that's, again, that's one of those plays where it's like, we got it. We look like geniuses. So, just, you know, talking points. It's easy to look back in hindsight, that kind of thing. But I feel like it's still fair to talk about that kind of stuff, too. You know, kudos to their defense. We tried running the ball, and they did a very good job stuffing us all night. You know, we were trying to hit everywhere. We found a little bit of success up the middle more often than not. I think we might have hit one or two on the outside zone plays, but they seem to have that pretty well stuffed up all night. I remember a guy behind us mentioning you know, oh, we haven't run outside all night, and I think we called outside zone like a dozen times. So that's just one of those things that could still, like, catch me off guard of, we've been watching this same game the entire time together, and we've seen two completely different things.
Yeah, I mean, I remember hearing that, but then there was also, like, people next to us going, why do we keep trying to run it to the outside? we're never hitting the edge on them once. And it's like, nope, that was a run up the middle. It was just stuff, so we had to bounce it. And that's kind of, you know, how our run game has been all year. It's, you know, you find a crease and it hits, or there's just absolutely nothing going.
Yeah, it's lacked that consistency. It's been a lot more boom-busty, which is tough, you know, as a from a play caller perspective, because it's like, yeah, if you get stuffed for two and then get a gain of 15 on the third one, I mean, that's a first down. It seems like it, you look at the numbers overall, it'd be easy, but, you know, you call first down, first and 10 gets stuffed, second and 9 tackle in the backfield, third and 11, you can't count on that one to hit it for a big one. So
yeah,
it's not a consistent thing we have in our offense, which is a little bit worrisome, but I mean, it's been working when it's needed to so far. You know, we get that last first down, we kill the clock, game's over, and turns out Lennox just decides to be an absolute stud, hit a hole, and run the score up a little bit. So, you know, we didn't need that last score. We could have ended the game, win by 3, but we finished it by 10, so hopefully that kind of soothes your anger about their late touchdown last year.
Kinda.
Kinda. All right, I can take kinda. That's generally a more positive response than we get from you, buddy.
Yeah. I mean, while we're going into the play calling, I mean, something noteworthy here is that we did see that Wildcat come out. So we ran one play of Wildcat with Owens, and he picked up 11 yards, I think. And, you know, obviously that's really nice to see. Anytime you can mix things up, anytime you can go plus one back there, I think it's something that we could implement moving forward. But I think we also need to expand off of it. I mean, I don't know what we do or don't have in the playbook, right? But we got that big first down off the Wildcat, and then we immediately took him out, which, again, I'm okay with. You know, I'm not, you know, there's some people saying just keep him out there, keep going. And, you know, maybe that works too. But, you know, he did what he did. You took him out. But my issue is that we took him out, and then we immediately went to a heavy set. And it's like, you're going to go to a heavy set, you might as well Wildcat, or you might as well stay plus one. And we ended up getting stuffed down there as soon as we got to the goal line. I mean, I think that last play, they put nine guys up on the line of scrimmage, and they're like, you're not running it. And it's like, well, we're going to try to run it anyway. And we didn't run it forward, at least. You know,
Yeah, that's one of those things. So it was kind of hard to see if it was like the Wildcat specifically, if it was a successful, like, blocked up good play, or if it was the one Owen's little brother, Xavier, I believe, that, or if he just, like, decided to be a dude that play and made something out of nothing. Mm-hmm. And that's one of those hold on, let me back up. The set we came out in, I think it was, we had an inline tight end, four receivers, and just Owens in the backfield, which I do understand, in that, at least in that field position in a vacuum where you get down close to the goal line, spreading the field with those receivers out wide isn't going to do much, because you're still going to be down a man in the red zone like that just by virtue of the spacing on the field. So my question would be, you know, you have that, you go to it, and then you immediately get out of it. You don't come back to it. Why didn't you come back to it? It could just be as simple as, well, they kind of matched it up. They did a good job defending it. We just happened to make a play, or our dude just happened to make a play in that, which you can't consistently count on. So, okay.
Yeah, but I mean, you can say the same thing about power. You can say the same thing about zone. Like none of our run plays have consistently worked.
Yeah.
Or if they have, we are calling them so sparsely because we want them to keep working, and we're just sacrificing the other ones. But, I mean, we've seen our run plays not work whatsoever, and then we've seen Gamble be a dude, or we've seen Lennox be a dude. So I don't have an issue with us not coming back to it. It's just one of those conceptual things for me. It's like, oh, we went Wildcat, and then we went heavy package with Slaughter back there? It's just kind of like counterintuitive to me.
Yeah, I get it, and so I would wonder.
And this is the first time we've showed it, and that could be the only play we have in Wildcat all day. You know, like, that's the only thing in the play.
Yeah,
but I'm just saying, let's build upon it now.
Oh yeah, no, I'm big on that. So I would assume just Xavier. I think he's only a sophomore. He's still pretty young, so you don't know how much you can put on him. You know, there are some, you get some high school players where they're like just in film watching, obsessed with it all, like know the entire side of the ball they're on, everybody's assignments. And then there's some kids where it's like you have to like draw it out for them on their hand. So it's you don't know how much workload the kid can have. Also, conceptually, I would like to see him in that heavy package as a Wildcat QB. That would be fun. That can be stuff you can expand upon. But then you get into like, okay, how do we make this work with everything? It's obviously you can just get him out there in reps and, okay, this is handoff left, this is handoff right, that's easy enough. And then it's from there,
yeah.
You know, you're just the ball carrier now, so how do you want to handle?
Well, we were using him in some of our two-back set earlier in the year. So, yeah. I mean, it's not like it's a kid off the streets. Like, he knows at least some of the offense, he knows some of the run plays, and you know, and yeah, I mean, whatever, we'll get there.
Yeah.
But I'm looking forward to us building on it.
Oh yeah, me too. But I think the main thing with keeping Slaughter in the heavy set was obviously you're not going to do it on the goal line, but having that big play action bomb in your back pocket that you wanted to get to at some point. So that might be the idea with that. I don't know. again, would love to see that built upon. I think it can be very dangerous, and, you know, that could be something fun, help get your run game going when you just really can't get anything else moving up front. So I think that's all I really have for the game, unless... Oh, you wanted to touch on the facilities. You made me make a note of that.
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things that I'd like to touch on. But yeah, the stadium was not good. I hope we never play there again. It just...
That high of an opinion, huh?
It just doesn't make sense for us to do it. It's a high-profile game, right? If we want to play somewhere... And it's not like it's their home field.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not, you know, they didn't go to class next door and they walked over after school was over. You know, I'd rather go to a neutral setting than play there again. The stadium was trash. The speakers sucked. The scoreboard didn't work. They didn't have a play clock. The only bathroom on our side, you had to, like, go through our locker room to get to it. You didn't literally go through the locker room, but their locker room didn't fit all of our kids.
Mm-hmm.
So half the players were outside the locker room, and they weren't just sitting around. Like, they had coaches out there with them. Like, they're doing stuff. Like, they're in meetings, pregame talks, and we had to walk through their meetings to get to the bathroom. That's the only way you could get there. It was just a not a great place. They have no parking. Mind you, there was more parking than I thought, but, you know, for that type of crowd, no parking, getting out of there sucked. It's just not a great place to have a large football game in general.
Yeah, I mean, all that stuff you said, it was pretty atrocious. That being said, my question would be, like, how are the facilities on the home side? Because if, like, Eds knew all that stuff coming in and they had a pretty decent setup over there, I almost kind of respect the gamesmanship of, we're not going to give your fans any place to park. We're going to make it wildly inconvenient for you guys to have to use the bathroom and, like, make the fans walk through the meetings of the, of, you know, your guys' team. But yeah, from a fan perspective, atrocious. You need to have a better venue for a game of that caliber.
Yeah. I mean, not that I love our away locker room. I don't know what it looks like now, but I remember when we played, I always thought that was not a great offering. You know, I never felt great about putting teams in our away locker room, but... you know, at least we didn't make it to where fans had to walk through you and like through your meetings and stuff. But yeah, it just wasn't a great place to play, and I'd be glad if we don't have to go back there.
Yeah, I wouldn't be mad at it either. I know another point that got you pretty heated during the game was let's call it reactions to play calls on the field that were very easy to for the defense to see, if you wanted to get into that one.
Yeah, so, I mean, I might be the only person in the world that does this for all I know, but I have always had the tendency of looking at receivers pre-snap because I feel like you can kind of tell what's coming based on how they're lined up, what their body motions are. But it's not just them. You can look at anybody and, you know, you can get reactions. So, like when we were going for it on that fourth down and nobody thought, you know, we didn't think we're going to go for it, but the whole team runs out there, they're pumped up, they're hyping up the crowd. And it's like, I don't think we are faking that. I mean, we either like really practice this on short notice, you know, or they're actually hyped up because we're going for it. And, you know, I don't have an issue with that. But like, that's why I was like, when they came out, I was like, I think we're going for this thing. Like, I don't think we're faking it. But then there's other times. So like this specific play, it was third down, maybe four had it been.
Yeah,
third.
It was like third and long, third and super long.
Yeah, so like third and long, and you know, we call on the play, we do all the hand signals, yada yada, and a receiver just like visibly starts throwing a fit because he's pissed off at the play call, and like half-ass lines up. He's like, I don't care. And I'm like, okay, well, Hank, I bet you $5 we're running the ball up the middle right here. And that's exactly what happened. And it's like, I understand that it's probably not quick enough for anybody to actually pick up on and relay it, but it's just a bad look. I mean, one, you know, it's just high. You're going to control your emotions a little bit, but then two, I mean, you're giving the play away, and you never know when somebody does pick up on that shit. You know, there's plenty of high IQ guys out there that notice it. It might be one in a million, but that one time somebody notices it, it could affect the game. So I'm just not a big fan of that kind of stuff in general. You know, I want to go back to the Big Mike machine gun dance. You know, it's not just that. I mean, you can't do gun dances. I mean, even in the NFL, they don't let you do that. That was like, it happened to Atlanta, and Atlanta's head coach, you know, came out on the press conference, and he was like, oh yeah, he was pretending to have a t-shirt gun to help out the fans. You know, those aren't real guns he's pretending to have. But it's just stupid. I see kids on our team that their celebrations and their dances with each other like have guns in the celebration. And it's a cultural issue across the board of where we're teaching our kids that you know, in order to look cool, you have to dance with fake guns in your hands. And like, it's stupid. You know, you're in the NFL, you know, you're not a gangster in the NFL. You know, you shouldn't be looking cool by having fake guns in your hands. You're cool because you're providing a life for your family that, you know, most people will never get to do. You're making millions of dollars. College kids, you are going to school for free. You're getting a great tuition. Like, you don't need guns in your hands. High schoolers, like, it's just a stupid precedent for me in general. So, like, you know, the machine gun one, at least it's like, it's still stupid, but it's not like realistic because, you know, they're not running around with MGs. But, you know, I just think anything gun related is a stupid, like, thing to show off in a celebratory manner. It's like, you can have a gun wall behind you for all you can. You know, I care. I mean, shit, I built that gun wall, but I'm not going to go around and hand gesture gun movements at people. It's just stupid to me. And it has no place in sports, in my opinion, and it should be a penalty. But that's what kids at all ages are seeing as being cool. You know, they may have never been around a firearm in their entire life, but they see it in a Fortnite dance, or they see an NFL player do it, or they see it in a music video. And it's just stupid, in my opinion. So, I mean, I don't know. You know, maybe this is just some dumb boomer take, but I don't see how pretending to have a gun in your handshake is, like, cool.
This is your soapbox, brother. I'm going to let you have it. I do not have that strong of an opinion one way or another, so I'm not really going to comment on it. I just did have the very funny visual of you saying the whole guns aren't cool thing and just looking at my gun wall that you built.
I didn't say guns aren't cool. You know, you can enjoy firearms and you can respect firearms and you can be very pro firearm while not going around and waving it at people.
Very true. Very true.
There's also something different about respecting real firearms and pretending to have guns in your hands while you're at a football game.
Also true. Also, yeah, kind of the mixing whole guns and high school sports is definitely an odd look, to say the least, to be as milk toast take about that one as I can. But I am extremely interested how we got here from kids giving away plays based on body language.
Because I wanted to go back to this earlier. And
all right.
I was like, you gave me my shot to go off about different things about the game, and this is one of the things I wanted to talk about.
All right, fair enough. Is that it for your soapbox on that particular issue?
Yeah, probably.
All right. Do we have anything else you want to touch on in the game?
Lennox is a good running back. And in the fourth quarter of games, down the stretch, he should be getting more touches.
Yeah.
You can't ride him the whole game because he plays defense. Mm-hmm. And he had one run earlier in the game where it was a hard, tough run, you know, broke off a tackle. And it's like, yeah, that's exactly what we need right there. You know, like Gamble, the starting running back, a very good running back in his own right. But, you know, when it comes crunch time or you need a yard, Lennox just has a little bit more oomph to him than Gamble does. And, you know, I think he's the kind of player we could ride in a fourth quarter when we need to. And I was kind of surprised we didn't use him a little bit earlier in the fourth quarter against Eds, because we were talking about it during the game. It's like, hey, once the end of the game comes around, like, expect Lennox to get out there. And he did, and it worked. But I think that's something to look forward to moving on. One last gripe.
I was just going to add something to your Lennox thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, you know, we've talked about plays going both ways on here before. I think it's high school ball. You go for it. You know, Gamble, great player in his own right. Everybody else we have in their own particular lane, I think they serve our offense very well in. But Lennox just has that little, I think he's a little more decisive as a ball carrier as well. I don't know.
He's also bigger.
Yeah.
He's a bigger back.
Yeah. And it's like, I haven't seen enough to say one way or another, like, oh, he's got better vision or this or that. It just seems like if he can find a crease and with his size and speed, he can hit that hole and get you a little more than Gamble did for most of the game. But yeah, like you said, he's not a guy. That's not a guy you want to give, you know, 35 carries to and then also count on him on defense. But, yeah, I would like to see him a little more in those got-to-have-it spots. So,
yeah, and, I mean, it helps that we had Big Mike out there with him. And, again, you don't want to use Mike on offense too much. But but that's just the kind of what I'm looking for. You know, you get when it comes down to crunch time, you know, players are going to have to man up and go both ways a little bit. And we did, which is great. I'm just saying the rest of the year, I would expect to see some of that more. You know, when you got to have it, you got to have it.
Damn right. So one last gripe. Let's hear it.
One last gripe. I got a fever. And there's only one prescription.
More cowbell?
More touches to Jock Carter.
Okay.
He was a decoy guy out there a couple of times, and a lot of our screens go away from him. You know, I understand the position he plays probably puts him out of position, but you know, sometimes you got to get the ball in your playmaker's hand. He's too good not to get the ball, and you know, he's our best receiver in space. He's our best yards after catch receiver we have. And I don't know. I mean, did he even have a catch?
I'm not sure. I can look that up. But, yeah, you know, there's I think it's a lot of coaches talk about on their call sheet. They have, you know, they'll have a section for that, like, get my guy his touches. And it can be tough a little bit when you don't just have, like, my guy on the team. We have a few different guys. But that actually – you reminded me with like this screen comment of, you know, I'm a big proponent of the tunnel screen. I think, you know, a lot of fans just hate it because it's just drilled in their memory of, we'll call it maybe once a game and it'll hit for like probably, you get about a 50% hit rate of, you know, get the conversion first down or even bigger or just getting absolutely stuffed up. But I think we caught it like 3 or 4 times during the game. And just from a more holistic perspective, you can't really call a screen, any type of screen, 4 times in a game and not expect the defensive lineman or the rest of the defense to be able to tee off on that. You know, as a D lineman, you might get caught off guard with the screen once, maybe even twice, but you know, by the time they call that 3rd or 4th one, it's like, you know where the ball is going to be going. Just retrace, follow the lineman, and then you're making a tackle for nothing.
Yeah, I mean, I don't hate it. I mean, we ran that a lot when we were in high school. Mm-hmm. And it had a pretty decent success rate. But, you know, usually we did it in space enough for the linemen weren't going to make the play. My issue with screens in general is that, you know, sorry, Hank, but linemen always miss at least one guy that just blows it up. So, you know, it either hits or it doesn't, which I'm still okay with, you know, because getting your athlete the ball in space, like, they can make a guy miss. But it's just annoying because there's always one lineman that runs right past somebody without blocking. Every single, and that's at every level, high school, college, NFL. Linemen just, there's always some kind of miscommunication of should I hit that guy or go get somebody else, or they just whiff because, you know, they're 300 pounds and they're trying to run outside the numbers. but I don't have an issue with it because, you know, worst case, like what? You don't get much out of it. I mean, that's the same as any of our other plays, you know? So, you know, give your guy a chance to go run for 80 yards. And if nothing else, you slow the defense down a little bit.
That's fair. Good counterpoint. I am surprised, though, because we whipped it out during Virgin Catholic, but that we didn't try to call the fake receiver screen and go at all.
Yes. So the way they were attacking our screen, you know, I loved it because they were just running right through the receiver or tight end that was attempting the block. They weren't going to sit there and patty cake with them. They basically know that you're out of the play, right? If you let him get hands on you, you're out of the play, and now your teammate is one-on-one. But if you can run right through them, it kind of helps blow it up a little bit, puts more pressure on the receiver catching it, maybe end up getting a holding call out of it. You know, there was a time where they ran it against us, maybe not the exact same thing, but, you know, they ran it against us and our defender came up and kind of got caught up in the block and, you know, didn't do anything. And it's like, yeah, that would have been a nice time where you just run him right over and it just causes chaos. You know, I feel like it's really difficult to actually get hands on with that receiver in space and then still make a play. So I actually really like the way that they were coming down so hard against it, but I'm surprised we never went with the fake because they were coming down so hard on it.
Yeah, they were playing it super aggressive. It's one of those things you can either like play soft and not necessarily patty cake it, but at least attack the shoulder opposite you want the ball carrier to go and know where he's to get him to go to that side because you know that your rest of your guys are going to be there. Or just be so violent you just disrupt it all and then hope the rest of the defense can rally if you can't make the play. So,
like, that would have been the perfect team for us to run the play we designed. Last week where we hit because they had the corner sitting back or you know whoever the second defender was, he kind of sat back. He didn't play it super aggressive. So if we just would have ran one guy up the sideline, it would have been covered. But if you released both guys, you could have caught him. And I know I texted you over the weekend because Michigan ran something similar to what we were talking about, where you faked the block, and then both receivers still went out.
Yeah.
And I think this would have been the perfect game for something like that because they're crashing down so hard.
Yeah. I mean, maybe they saw something else from the rest of the defense that, you know, as a fan, you're not going to necessarily have eyes on that would have covered it up. But I don't know. That, again, more shit I would like to know in the background that we don't necessarily have to bring to the show.
Yeah, you would have to call it as a, well, I guess you'd have to, I guess either way, it has to be a design call, right? Yep. I was going to say you wouldn't have time to run it because of illegal men downfield, but we're running, yeah. Oh, never mind. It would have to be a dedicated call anyway. It's not like we're doing power right, tag, fake.
Yeah, no, you're having your offensive lineman, they're pass blocking. Yes.
Yeah, so it wouldn't make a difference. We could install that.
So actually with that, that reminded me about what you said about, you know, not getting the ball to Jacques. So he ended the game 3 catches for 17 yards. Not a one of those really sticks out in my mind. Maybe it was like on one of the quick outs or something we ran. But, you know, we tried going for the deep ball a couple times, but their defensive line was just living in our backfield. It was our O-line was having trouble holding up in pass pro. That was a mismatch, I thought, that, you know, going into the game. So maybe that fake screen and go was just a matter of wouldn't have enough time pass blocking wise to get it off. But, you know, I remember later in the game, it felt like we were just either running the ball or trying to get the ball out quick. And it's like, okay, maybe go for a deep shot here. And I think we just dialed up that, you know, post dig deep shot we had, and Slaughter just had to eat the sack because the defense was in the backfield, you know, before he could really get into his reads. So, again, kudos to their defense. They were swarming all night. We just happened to get the better of them. It's really weird saying that coming out of the game with 31 points and winning by 10, but still, we had a tough night up front, but we managed to eke through.
Yep.
So, any more gripes, comments, concerns, or soapboxes?
No. We got to keep this thing under an hour. It's not going to happen, but let's keep it under an hour and a half.
All right. We can do that. So, with that, we'll get rolling right into film room, and we will see y'all on the other side. All right. So, first up, we have the big touchdown to go up and take a lead into halftime from the end zone view. I did find this on Slaughter's huddle from the other side, but I don't think it really does the throw justice. So
yeah, I mean, we saw this on Twitter, this NEO Zone account that was kind of posted up right here in the end zone. They had a few different clips throughout the game, but you know, this is one where you can really see Slaughter just do a hell of a job. And he navigates the pocket. Great block by Gamble, inside out. But Slaughter shifting to his right and then throwing, you know, this left hand back kind of across the middle to a receiver running to the left. Just an absolute beautiful throw, great catch, and, you know, touchdown going to half. We really needed this, and overall great play.
Mm-hmm. And just right through this lane. I mean, this is what impresses me, just getting it, you know, between the defense like that with the arm. You know, they talk about quarterbacks throwing it with different arm angles and off platform and all that, and this is exactly what they're talking about. It's not always going to be that, you know, picture perfect three-step drop, back foot hits, your same throwing motion every time. It's, you're going to have to throw off platforms through some weird angles and shit, and this is just that to a T. And yeah, shout out Gamble there, getting the block off the edge. Obviously scanning inside out and just catching that guy who is otherwise has a free rush to the quarterback. That is, you know, good running backs can be dudes with the ball in their hands. Great running backs can block. And that is blocking.
Yeah, line does a good job there holding up. I know maybe a little bit of interior pressure against the center and maybe some pressure on the left side, but really Slaughter has a pretty decent pocket.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's starting to press in on him a little bit, but you know, line holds up. You know, it's nice to see that we have gotten a little bit healthier. Got a senior out there at right tackle, and we moved around a little bit. I don't know if you really noticed that, but we moved some guys around when we go like heavy.
Yeah.
And we bring in, yeah, so, but I mean, it's nice, you know, we're getting healthier and we have some more options, and, you know, they're starting to gel a little bit better now.
Yeah, and, you know, you're not always going to have that perfect pocket, and against tough teams like this with a really good defensive front like Ed's has, that is about as perfect as you're going to get. I mean, like you said, center, he gets pushed a little bit, but he does an astounding job anchoring down and kind of,
yeah, like,
gaining his footing back, keeps those feet moving. That is, you know, when you're, for lack of a better term, kind of getting your ass beat on the bull rush, that is about as good as you can get it, and that's good stuff right there. So let's see here. Next up, I included this play because up until this point, it seemed like Slaughter always, he kind of had the Josh Allen thing of like just the Green Goblin mask in the back of his head, just when a play breaks down, just do the worst thing possible. Of, you know, there's a couple times last year where we try and call a halfback screen and nothing goes right, and then he scrambles around, makes a play downfield. You know, if you just watch that specifically in and of itself, great play, except, oh, illegal man downfield, coming back for 5 yards, waste of time. Here, we hit him with this a couple times. We go 2x2 stack, hit him with like a quick out RPO from the off-ball guys with, and it's an RPO, so you have a run play attached. So I'll let it roll. Obviously, his first look doesn't want to take the ball there because the defender's just kind of sitting on it. Goes to throw it, thinks better of it, and just scrambles for a couple yards. Really saving a play, saving yards on a big, what, third and five? If he tries to throw it right there, you know, you got guys 3, 4, 5 yards downfield. Shout out Zat Davenport, got his helmet ripped off. You know, usually you see a illegal hands to the face there because helmets don't just tend to fall off by themselves in the middle of a play, but that's neither here nor there. But, I mean, he does a good job just tucking it and making something out of nothing.
Yeah, I mean, I was impressed with this, you know, watching it live, because he pulled it back down. You know, we ran this earlier in the game and he threw it right away and we got a couple yards out of this. This time looks like he went to throw it. You know, route really wasn't quite there yet. And then he has to tuck in and run and make something out of it. And, you know, he's a pretty good runner when he chooses to go for it. You know, a lot of people don't give him enough credit for being as athletic as he is. But, you know, really make something out of nothing here. And I remember that there was a flag on this play that they ended up picking it up.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder, you know, I assumed it was like a legal hands to the face on the defense because, you know, Davenport's helmet falls off. Which, you know, it comes off pretty easy. You got to tighten that up, kid. But they ended up waving it off. And I wonder who throws it, actually. Because I wonder if they're assuming, like, a legal man downfield. But then since he never throws it, it can't be.
No, it was the, what's that specific one? He's sitting right there with the linebackers. He just kind of like half-ass tosses it into the field after the ball goes.
Yeah, I wonder if I mean, he's looking right at Davenport. So, I mean, if they don't get illegal hands to the face, maybe they're looking for like illegal participation because he kept playing without a helmet.
Yeah.
And then the other refs had it sound like, nah, we're not doing that.
I mean, he is doing a great Adam Sandler impression from The Longest Yard where loses his helmet and just still keeps getting after it. That's that kind of nastiness I want to see out of my offensive lineman. So,
yeah, I mean, he's looking right at it and he throws the flag. So I don't know how you don't call that if you saw him push his helmet off, but
yeah, I don't know, but great play by Slaughter, having that moment of the, like I said, the Green Goblin mask, like whispering to him, just throw it right there, and then tucks it. And like you said, he's got that athleticism to him. You know, we called a power read with him against Eds last year in the game. Like, he's not some statue back there, obviously, but he's not some kid that, you know, can't take off when he needs to. So, just wanted to highlight that one.
I kind of would like to see this play out a little bit longer because, you know, you kind of had the 2-on-1 there.
Mm-hmm.
If that linebacker fills a little bit more, you know, they don't really like fake the handoff like you would see at the higher level.
Yeah.
You know, like where they're really showing the ball and waiting to see what you're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was like, I know I'm going to throw it right away, but then the receiver wasn't open right away, so now just plays dead because, you know, I think he could have handed it off and we had something there.
Yeah, so that's
we kind of had the 2-on-1, but by time the route develops, you know, the line's already moving.
Yeah, I think what he sees when he pulls it is that corner at the field just kind of, or to the boundary, just sitting there waiting on it, hips not turned, nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, I wouldn't throw the out route right here either.
Oh yeah, no.
But the stick kind of opens up, and if you would have rode out the handoff a little bit longer, I think that linebacker would have sucked up even more. But, you know, whatever.
Yeah. So I think with that, you know, you see a lot of you see a handful of teams will do like a post snap RPO where he's actually reading it after the ball is snapped and riding it through. That is opposite of where the running back is coming from, but the vast majority of teams, you're going to have like any kind of post-snap RPO is going to be to the side of the running back. So something in this instance, I'm just kind of assuming they teach it as if you see the corner just sitting off at the beginning, you know, that's a lot of space there. You're probably expecting the corner to turn and bail because it's a cover three, cover four look. 1, 2, 3, 4, cover four look, I'm guessing, but
why though? It's third and four, and they're giving you a two high. Why would you assume the corner's not gonna sit at the sticks?
Playing off, maybe he's bailed all night. I don't know.
And it's a stack, which would make me think the corner's gonna be even more aggressive. But I'm not a quarterback. I'm not the one that decides how to read these things. But
yeah. So my whole spiel, the point of that was, this is at least that side of it is probably a pre-snap read of you get the look you like, then you're just going to pull it you're going to catch and throw and not even pretend to ride the handoff or care about the run play at all.
This is a pre-snap RPO. I mean, I get it.
Yeah. So
mind you, Will Howard with Ohio State had a really nice away from the handoff post-snap RPO last week.
Yeah. No, they definitely do it. I mean, yeah, I remember seeing film.
That was nice.
Joey B, when he was at LSU, I think Tua at Alabama and in the NFL, it's stuff you do see at the higher levels, but maybe not something you're comfortable asking your quarterback with. And, you know, also at the end of the day, he's a kid. If he thought he could make that throw, then he's probably going to try and make that throw, but ends up thinking better of it. So this, I think, is the play before the touchdown, and I just wanted to appreciate because we got power blocked up damn near perfect here.
Yes, this is 4th and 2.
Yep.
Or 4th and...
4th and something.
Maybe this was the play before that, even?
I don't know. None of the huddle highlights come with down and distance, unfortunately. Especially from the end zone
view. I don't think this was the 4th down play.
Yeah, no. Maybe. He ended up fighting for that. Whatever. We don't need to talk through the thoughts. Can't remember what it was, but so normally with this look, just I wanted to, you know, kind of point out with this kind of look, you're under power right, so you're expecting, so 57, your tight end, he's just going to basically base block that defensive end, outside linebacker there, kick him out of the hole. Your tackle and guard are going to double down on that 2-eye up to the backside backer. Left guard's going to pull around for the play side backer. But what the backers end up doing, I think it's a called blitz, the play side backer just comes down hard and the backside backer scrapes over top. So the double team ends up working to the play side backer coming down. The backside guy, he pulls around and takes on that scraping linebacker, which, you know, based on your roles, are not going to be the guys you take. So just a great post-snap adjustment by the lineman. And since I spelled all that out, now you can watch it. And also Mike, Big Mike coming down through the hole and laying some cat out.
Yeah, I mean, that's... I know that they have a really talented front,
mm-hmm.
but to only give us a 6-man box in this look, you know, I feel like they are asking for it.
Yeah, it's tough because, I mean, you can see, like, our backside tackle really has nowhere to go. Our wing, you know, number 4, gap hinges like he's supposed to, and then Davenport really doesn't have anywhere to go, so he's lost in the sauce. You know, we get, what, a 10-12-yard gain with one guy who has no one to block necessarily?
Yeah, I mean, they want that little cross-dog blitz, and left guard does a good job of picking that up.
Yeah, and it's...
I mean, it probably isn't a huge difference for him because he's looking for somebody filling right there anyway.
So... normally with this look, and especially with that guy head up to vaguely shaded inside of you, you're kind of expecting to stay on him the entire time as a guard. And then your tackle against, you know, a base defense is going to come off to take on that backside backer scraping across. So you don't
The left guard pulls, right?
Yeah.
And you're expecting him to stay on who?
So, left guard, if I'm drawing this up on a whiteboard, is pulling across to take on the play side backer. He'd probably hit him closer to the hole. Your right tackle, right guard are double teaming down to the backside backer.
Backside backer, yeah.
Yeah. And with that guy lined up a little bit inside the right guard, pre-snap, I would be expecting him to stay on me and my left tackle to come off the double team and attack the backside backer scraping down. So for the right guard to see that DN kind of trying to jump over to the C-gap and that play side backer coming down aggressive like that, really good post-snap adjustment.
Okay. It took me a second since you started talking about people way out of the play, but
sorry.
I get what you're saying. Yeah, so that three tech or whatever is shooting outwards.
Yeah.
Which is catching the right guard, right tackle off guard.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, because, I mean, if he doesn't, you know, the right tackle theoretically could have just intercepted that backside backer cross-dogging.
Yeah.
And then left guard and Big Mike would have just both been up to the safety at that point.
Yeah, so if the right guard doesn't pick up the play side backer coming down, you just have a free runner in the A-gap. Because that double team, you essentially, the way the basic mechanics of a double team is you both attack half the guy, you both get eyes on your backer you're working up to, and whatever side the backer comes to, if he's coming to my side, I come off the double team and attack him. If he comes to the other guy's side, he comes off the double team and I take over the full guy we're on. But it's the fact that he's coming down, he's not the backer I'm going to have eyes on in the first place. Yep. Which is what is impressive to me.
I saw a cool lineman drill online the other day where they were working that. A two-man block working up to another guy, and then whichever way he went, they would pass it off.
Yeah, I don't know that drill specific, but that's like a, you know, day one camp offensive line indie drill type period that you're going to drill that until the sun goes down.
Yeah.
So now, it wasn't blocked up as pretty, but the touchdown run, you know, 6 points looks a lot better than a perfectly blocked 8-yard gain. You know, left guard.
Is that number 14 that just goes to the wrong hole? No?
Huh?
Hold on. Ooh. 43. That's their, like, All-American, isn't it?
Oh.
Completely abandons the gap that when it hits. He's right there.
I don't know if he thought he was going to bounce it or if he saw Big Mike coming downhill hard. Either way,
because Big Mike ends up leaving him and going to another backer. But,
I mean,
43 squeezes down and stays in his gap.
I mean, it's still first down, but that's a tough scene.
Well, it was already first down.
Yeah. Wait, was this already...
This play right here is first down.
Okay, and we just needed like one run to kill the clock.
No.
Yeah.
We didn't need anything. We could have kneeled it. We went for it. For no reason. We could have kneeled the game away right there.
Well, it was...
But we decided to run a play anyway.
It was above 2 minutes. They still had a timeout.
The game was over. We could have just kneeled it away right here.
They still had a timeout left. They still had one or two timeouts, actually.
Oh,
and it was
the game was over.
I recall thinking in the game that we needed one more play, like real play, before we could kneel it out. But regardless,
what is a real play versus a kneel? It's the same thing. If you're not getting a first down. So either say we needed one more first down or the game is over. It doesn't make a difference if you run it or kneel it.
That's more the gamesmanship. If you run it, you're in like second and five. You feel them out if they want to call a timeout or not. If they
obviously would have called a timeout.
And then you're in a better spot to run the ball and pick up first down.
Well, we're going to have to fact check this because I saw other people, including like the Booster Club's report, that we could have just kneeled it away.
Oh.
And I remember watching this play and I'm going, why aren't we just kneel? And he broke it off as soon as I said that. Kneeling. Oh. Yay.
What the fuck are we doing? Hey, go team.
Run it up. Run it up.
Onside kick. Let's go.
Yeah.
But. Yeah, I mean, hell of a play to ice the game. They do a good job kind of mucking it up front, and if 43 comes downhill and hits his gap like he should, I mean, at least the loss looks better on their scoreboard. But
I don't know if you've seen, you probably saw it, I doubt you have it on film, but the that NEO Zones clip of this,
Yeah, from the end zone angle.
or Becca's clip of this from the end zone angle. And Big Mike as a blocker is, you can't tell from this angle too much, but he's not getting into the guy's chest with two hands and trying to extend. It's just he's 285 pounds and he really just has to kind of bump into you. And from the other angle, you can see it better than this one. But Mike just kind of left shoulder into that guy's chest and just completely knocks him out of the way. And Lennox is like, yeah, I'm just going to follow Big Mike.
Follow Big Mike to the
Because
promised land.
he's 285 pounds and he's not getting blown back.
Yeah.
I mean, at the very minimum, you're going exactly where Big Mike's butt goes.
Right.
Like, it's not getting blown back into you. So, but yeah, Mike just kind of like, there's nothing like super pretty about it. He just makes sure to get into the defender, doesn't super lunge at him, doesn't try to hit stick him, just secures the solid block and knows I'm 285 pounds. And if I kind of hit you with a little bit of momentum, it is opening a hole.
Yeah. And he's not the tallest guy, and 285 high school weight for a relatively short football player, you'd expect guys to look a little more sloppy, but he is built like a brick shit house. If you try and hit him, you're really not going to be moving, any farther forward than he's going to let you. You're going to know he's there. So it's definitely one of those. I think he kind of knows who he is as a blocker, which just makes it fun because he can just go out there and hit whoever he wants, and most people really can't do anything about that.
Yeah, it's not like he's lined up, nose to nose with a defensive tackle. Like, he's in linebackers and safeties with a head start. It doesn't take much. And I just really appreciate that form of blocking because like it almost looks lazy, but I think it's just the most efficient way for him to block.
Yeah.
Like he's not gonna whiff by doing that. He's not gonna miss the block. It's simple. It's just easy, straight to the point. All I have to do is just kind of nudge you a little bit.
Yep. Just a little nudge, and five is off to the promised land. All right. Let's see what else we got because I can't remember the film I saved. Oh, yeah. Just a couple clips of our run defense and Big Mike being an absolute stud. We saw a lot of this all night, them trying to go stretch and just meeting Big Mike in the hole. And he just like, I don't know, there's something about it in real time where he just like hits them, wraps them up, and he's like, yep, we're just going to the ground together right now. Go to sleep, go to sleep, go to sleep, go to sleep. But.
Yeah, I mean, they didn't. I mean, great job of our defense, but they didn't block that up real well, did they?
No.
Center comes off Mike a little early, but it's because both of our inside backers are crashing, which he doesn't really end up blocking either one of them because I guess he gets on Allman a little bit there. But I mean, great job. Obviously, Mike getting off of that block, getting back to the inside, but our linebackers are right there.
Yeah, I mean Vito does a great job coming downhill hard, setting the edge without being too aggressive. All of our linemen kind of, hold their water. Backers slow play it a little bit, and then you got Lennox back there as the cutback guy, just nowhere to go. And that's kind of what they ran into all night long.
Yeah, that's a great play down here also. Of course, I can't read his number. I think it's 68. That's one of the sophomores, right?
Yeah.
Just completely blows up that left guard. And like the right tackle comes in to like try and save him, but I guess, but like what is the right tackle going to do at that point?
You're not doing
You know,
much.
he's already beat. Go get a linebacker,
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's like you got hands on, maybe try and do something, just keep trying to wash them down at worst. You're opening up the cutback a little bit, but yeah, he does a great job shooting his gap. I mean, he shoots all the way damn near into A gap. But yeah, No, that's just the stonewall front we put up all night. Next play, kind of similar. This one's a little more a fun play, at least from an X's and O's perspective from St. Ed's. They're running a little counter bash. It's, if you're an NFL fan, that's a play Lamar Jackson's made a lot of money on in the league. I believe the line, so they're blocking counter Trey Wright. So left guard and left tackle are pulling. Left guard getting the kickoff block, left guard wrap, or left tackle wrapping. Running back is running sweep left, and you're reading the end man on the line of scrimmage is the quarterback. If he crashes down, hand it off to the running back on the sweep, and he can go make a play in space. If he stays home or just, you know, defense, we don't really present a great read guy for this play. But so the quarterback ends up pulling it, and he is now the runner behind the offensive line on counter. But again, our defense just decided you're really not going to have much daylight running anywhere.
Yep.
You know, 94 does a good job boxing the kick out. Big Mike gets uncharacteristically blown off the ball a little bit, but ends up fighting his way back in, making a play. Who is it? Nine? What's Nine's name? Mike Backer?
Williams?
Sure. So Niner does a great job getting in there.
He had like 16 tackle points.
Oh, yeah.
In this game.
That's like third most in a single game in Massillon history, isn't it?
Something like that. I still hate how they calculate
the
that.
The tackle point, yeah.
Yeah, Jaden Williams.
Yep.
Yeah, because assists count the same as solos.
They count the same?
Yes.
I thought it was half a point.
That's like the traditional way of doing it. That's like how the NFL does
it. Yeah.
We don't do it that way. So really, I think, you know, I could probably find the stat sheet somewhere, but he had like five tackles and 12 assists or something like that.
Gotcha. So, I mean, hey, it's you do a good job just making sure you're in there all game and you can get your name in the record books. But he does a good job coming inside, taking on that the pulling tackle and working inside the block, which is, I think, where we wanted this to go with the defensive call. Looks like we're boxing it more than spilling it. But regardless, they don't have much going here. And, you know, good to see the safeties coming down, be aggressive. We talked about that after the Burgeon Catholic game, and we just didn't really give them much of any breathing room. So with that, I believe that's all the film we have of the Eds game, and we could turn the page unless you found something else you were looking up.
Nope.
Cool. Alrighty. So now we look ahead at DeMatha. This is from their game against Archbishop Spalding, who's, I think, the number one team in Maryland.
Yeah, they're like the number 11 team in the country right now.
Yeah. So nice little quick, not quite play action, quick dig with a flat route. Hit him over the middle. Not bad. So one thing that like caught my attention right away with this stuff is just how sloppy and like not much attention to detail the operation of the offense seems to have, where it's, you know, you're kind of running a half-assed jet sweep fake here. He almost runs into the running back. Ball ends up in a spot where there's basically two receivers. So,
yeah.
It's just, like, that was a very recurring theme I saw watching this film. But, you know, quarterback's got an arm. He can throw it, but they also use him quite a bit as a runner. It's definitely something we got to look out for. And they're not even trying to get cute with any kind of read option or anything, just straight up sweep. But, you know, just there again, it's not like that first play was where the guys just messed up a little bit. When you got the motion guy just running into the running back trying to get into his pass pro, it just looks tough.
Yeah.
Here is something the quarterback likes to do a lot. Not much going downfield on a deep pass. Just tuck it and run it. Get the yards you can. And that is something he likes to do quite a bit. He's not just going to like dance around and try and get the edge out of the pocket. If he sees a lane up the middle, he's going to take it. But you know, you can see number 11 team in the country gets the job done. One more quick little highlight from the end zone view. I believe they handled this team pretty thoroughly, but you get a good chance to see what they're working with here. First one was just a little spot route. This one looked like, you know, good old power option. If you watched any Massillon games last year, you'd know we ran that quite a bit. And just seeing they ran the hell out of the QB. Any thoughts? Anything you want to watch back before we get out of here?
No, I think a lot of things we can address on the next segment. We'll cover this as well.
All right. Sounds good. All right. So the number 3 team in Maryland and the number 35 team in the nation, DeMatha, coming in with a 2-1 record, dropped their season opener to Archbishop Spalding, 26-10. You know, like we said, they're the number 11 team in the nation, but came right back out, beat an 0-5 team from Maryland, 48-0, and then beat a Roman Catholic out of Pennsylvania, 49-12. So, you know, good team, got a lot of team speed. Mm-hmm. I question if the details are there, but with that, let's get into the roster.
Yep, so they have a large offensive line, the left side maybe a little bit better than the right side. 6'5", 300, 6'1", 310, 6'3", 285, 6'3", 290, 6'4", 290. So pretty large up front, but, you know, not the best offensive line we've seen this year. But, you know, once again, playing just a humongous offensive line. So, you know, it's nothing we're not used to at this point.
Yeah, nothing really sticking out name-wise, I guess. I don't know. Anthony Schumann. Schumann, not a bad offensive line name, but otherwise pretty unremarkable considering how big this team is.
They've got a couple good receivers. Their main receiver is a junior, 5'11", 170, going to Penn State. But they have a few other guys also, 5'10", 160, 5'10", 175, and 6'3", 185 is the other receiver that they like to target. But you know, the name of the game here is that they have a lot of good athletes on this team. They have some good size up front, but the offense runs through their quarterback, Denzel Gardner, 6'1", 185. I believe he's a 4-year starter for them. He is committed to play football at Marshall, but just really good athlete. You know, we just saw him make some good throws. You know, you don't really talk about him as a passer as much as him as a rusher, but, you know, he can make the throws. And, you know, even if the offense in general didn't maybe looked a little sloppy by Hank's standards. He's still capable of making those throws, and they have a lot of athletes, and they have a lot of speed. So, I mean, this is going to be the most athletic, fastest team we've seen this year. But that offense, it's going through the quarterback, and they're more of a run-first team than a pass.
Yeah. Running back number two, Bud Coombs, great name. He's no slouch himself. He's committed to Maryland, so he's not going to be traveling far from home. But, yeah, like you said, they offensive line, got a lot of size up front. They got, one receiver with, I would say, above average size, but the rest of them, they got a lot of speed, but there's nobody that's there that's going to just, intimidate you walking in the building, just how they look in pads. But not to take anything away from them, they're still very good, very fast in their own right. They run power, counter, zone, jet sweep, a lot of called QB runs, and then the passing game, they're taking shots downfield quite a bit. I don't think they really don't have much in the way of checkdowns or that kind of thing. I think their version of the checkdown is the quarterback tucking the ball and just running right up the heart of the defense.
Yeah, moving over to their defense. Defense line has some size. 6'3", 245, 6'2", 285, 6'1", 310, 6'4", 225. But really, they rotate on the defensive line for running downs and passing downs. So they rotate some guys in that are more for speed pass rushing, and then more that are for run stopping. That sophomore, 6'4", 225, he has an offer to go to Florida, and he's more of their pass rusher guy. But they will rotate some guys around, including one of their offensive linemen, Hank's favorite guy there. He'll play some defense, specifically on rushing downs.
Yeah, not necessarily remarkable names for a defensive line, but this is like perfect numbering for a defense. You have your DNs, number 9 and number 11, just great, low-digit skill guy numbers for down on the line at a position you want to see that at. And then you got 99 and 53 up the middle. That is just grade A type numbering for my guys up front there.
Yeah, so moving to the linebackers, 6'1", 180, 6'1", 215, 6'2", 210, so pretty good-sized linebackers there. They are all seniors. And what do you think about their numbers?
Every single one of them are single-digit. For as good as the defensive line numbering is, these are horrible. You have 7, 8, and 6 back there and playing in the backer spots? No, god-awful. Give me a 44, a 50, 52. No, I want to say 55, but that's kind of like reserved in this part of the area. 34, yeah, something like that. I need some double digits a little bit farther up there. I can't just have 7, 8, and 6. I'm attacking the backers all night if I see that. I don't care how good they are.
Move on to the safeties. 6'1", 180, 6'2", 175. Both really good players in their corners. 5'10", 160, 6'2", 175. They are both good players too.
Yeah. 32 seems to be a little bit out of position number wise as a strong safety, but they play him rolled down plenty. And he's got a cool name, Nigel Cross, but spelled N-I-J-E-L. So
Nigel.
God damn it. It's the funky spelling that messed me up, all right? But all right. My boy Nigel, his name's spelled cool, and it's not a common number you see from a safety, so he gets a pass. I like it.
Yeah, so I mean we're kind of beating through it and trying to cut down how long the podcasts are, but this team's really good. I mean, what did you say? They're like 35 in the country.
Yep.
I think I just looked it up and I saw like 53. So I guess it depends on, where you look. But they have like 10 players with D1 offers. Mm-hmm. So, this is a really good team. And I was reading up on it a little bit earlier. And their current coach was their longtime coach. But he retired. And then he came back. Mm-hmm. And his coaching record at DeMatha before he retired was something ridiculous. And then, you know, so I wonder if, you know, something happened when he left, and then, you know, they're trying to, you know, build it back up. And, you know, I think I remember this being, you know, one of those notable teams from across the country that you used to hear about a little bit more than you did before. But, you know, when he originally retired, he had a record of 280 wins and 39 losses.
Ooh, buddy, that's a pretty good win-loss record right there.
Since then, since coming back, he's 35-18.
Okay, so
still a good record, but you know, not that 90% wintile anymore. So, you know, they have some really good athletes, plenty of guys with D1 offers, but you know, I wonder if things have changed a little bit with his second go around of coming back to coach, and if everything still translates the same way that it used to. And
yeah, I mean, something like that, I would imagine a lot of those losses came early in his second go around, as like he's trying to build it back to what it was. This is probably what, you know, something like McKinley was hoping for when McDaniels came back for a year. But obviously that didn't work out. This seems to be going a little bit better in their favor. So yeah, obviously not the powerhouse they were, but you know, it seems like they're trying to get back there, get on the right foot, and you know, they're no slouches. They got a lot of juice to them. They got some studs.
Oh, absolutely.
But there's just some of that, like watching, and I know this was week one of their season, and you're not going to be perfect week one, but there just seemed like, you know, when you're a high-end team and you're playing other high-end teams, the devil's in the details, and that's where you're going to separate the good from great teams. And it's just like the consistent sloppiness I saw in their highlight reel that gave me pause on a lot of stuff. It was, you know, who was that team that came in last year, week eight, that we had to call early because the coaches just lost control of them? I don't think it's, you know, quite to that level, but it's in that same kind of vein of they got a lot of dudes, but as a football program and a football team, it's not as good as you would want to see from a high-end team like I think they want to be.
Yeah, I mean, even with that, you go head-to-head with somebody that's, you know, a top 11 team in the country right now. You know, once you start getting inside of the top 15, it's insane the level of competition, right? You know, we're in the top 25 right now, and you know, I think we've gotten down to like 17, 18 before, something like that. Mm-hmm. But really, you get inside the top 15, and that's when you're talking about the full-time football academies, where you're getting players from across the country to come play for you. It's not even high school ball anymore. So Archbishop Spalding, number 11 team in the country right now, and they went toe-to-toe with them. I know they lost, but it wasn't a blowout. I don't remember what the final score was. It was something pretty close, though, wasn't
21-10.
It?
21-10. So it's like a
21-10.
Yeah, it's respectable.
Yeah. So, I mean, you're kind of like, yeah, you're right there. So, I mean, they went head-to-head with them, and, you know, I hope we're not, like, brushing off of them too quickly. I'm more or less doing it for the sake of keeping the podcast short, but, yeah. You know, this is a nationally ranked team, and you go back a little bit of time, you go back a decade, and this was a national powerhouse. You know, not that being ranked 35th in the country right now is a slouch, but you know, they have plenty of talent. They have a huge pool of players to pull from in that area. And, you know, it's going to be a really good team coming into Paul Brown Tiger Stadium this week.
Yeah, so with that, you know, get out there on Friday night, get behind the team, make it loud, make it a tough environment to play in. It's another team this kind of reminds me of, in a way, East St. Louis. And, you know, we only had like...
East St. Louis is doing good right now, too.
Yeah, they're up there.
They're up there, like top. Of course, I just saw two different things, but I think they're in the top 25 yeah. right now also.
But, you know, we only had like 5,000 people in Paul Brown that night. It would have been a real shame to miss that one, but...
yeah, couldn't be that guy.
Couldn't be me. But, you know, we got...
That was such a good game. But, yeah, the loudness of the crowd
mm-hmm.
noticeably affected the game.
Yeah. So if everybody can get in there, get your butts in the seats, get loud, get rowdy, you can, you know, you can help the Tigers win this thing. Get, disrupt them. Don't let them hear the play calls. For the love of God, don't start cheering defense like as soon as they spot the ball, when the team's not going to be like not even huddling up for another 8 seconds. Like, we need to work on that, guys. Like, let's, you wait when they get in the huddle, then you can start getting loud, and then when they get to the line, get even louder, try and drown out their checks and calls and stuff. Don't tire yourself out before they're even breaking the huddle.
Yeah, the idea is you should be the loudest as they're going through the cadence, mm-hmm. not when they're in the huddle. You know, if it dwells out too early, then it's just silent when the play goes off, and that's not what you want.
Exactly. So it's going to be a tough one. This is a bit of a meat grinder of a schedule, but I think, you know, that's who we think we are now. So I love to see this kind of shit, and it's looking like another good game coming into Paul Brown Tiger Stadium on Friday night. So,
absolutely.
So with that, do we want to try and speed run any spreads, or is that something we're leaving on the cutting
room floor? Let's do it. I haven't looked at these yet either.
Ooh.
So this is gonna be my first time reading it.
All right.
But I think we can just kind of speed through.
Yep.
Manchester at Canton South. Manchester is favored by 2.5.
Don't know.
Manchester is currently 5-0.
Give me Manchester.
Orville is traveling to Fairless. Orville is 4.5-point favorites.
Don't know much about Fairless. It usually a little bit harder traveling on the road. Give me Orville.
Central Catholic at Louisville.
Louisville.
19.5 points. Glen Oak traveling to Hoover. Hoover is favored by 17.5.
Ooh, 17.5 is a lot for a group of white boys. But Glen Oak does not have much going on. What's Glen Oak's record right now?
Last week, Glen Oak lost to Lake 27-0, and that has been their closest game of the year.
Hoover, pound Hoover. Don't think twice.
What a horrible stat. We lost 27-blank, but it was the best game we had. Jackson going to Perry. Perry, 9.5-point favorite.
Perry's a bit of a powerhouse this year. I'm still just on principle fading Central and St. V, but I got to go with Perry until they prove me wrong.
Yeah, so this could be an interesting one. So Jackson's 2-3 on the year, mm-hmm. but their three losses are to teams that are combined 14-1 on the year.
You know what? I like that. Jackson can be a little feisty. Give me Jackson to cover at the minimum.
So then you have Perry that was looking amazing mm-hmm. up until last week when they got slaughtered by McKinley 38-7.
Oh, I did not know that one. This is going to tell me a lot about Perry. I'm kind of back and forth if they just come out flat, kind of defeated, or if they come out with something to prove. I think Wakefield's going to get the boys up, so I'm actually switching back to Perry now.
McKinley's traveling to Green. McKinley is favored by 16.5.
Holy shit. My, how the mighty have fallen. And by mighty, I mean a solid two-year run. Give me McKinley to drop the ball so Green at least covers.
Glenville is playing St. Ed's. I think this is the game that's at Baldwin Walls, mm-hmm. maybe. St. Ed's is favored by 18.5.
Holy shit. Glenville at least has been tough in the last couple years, but Ed's is going to be coming out with something to prove for the remainder of the season. So give me Ed's comfortably.
Akron traveling to Ohio.
Ew.
OU is favored by 12.5.
Does Akron have the quarterback back?
I don't know. I was pretty good, though.
Let's not overthink this. OU, oh yeah.
North Carolina at Duke. Duke, 2.5-point favorite.
North Carolina got beat so bad by a team that just moved up at a D1 ball that Mack Brown tried to retire, and his team said no. So I think his team's going to be fighting for him a little bit harder on this one. Give me UNC.
Louisville at Notre Dame. Notre Dame 6.5.
It's pronounced Louisville. You have to say it like you Louisville. Have a mouthful of something.
Louisville. Louisville.
Notre Dame, they're non-conference, so they have to put together a resume. I know, like, the number 5 team in the playoffs is a sweet spot to be because you don't really you don't get the bye, but you don't really face that many high-seeded teams earlier in the playoffs. So I think Notre Dame, after dropping the ball early, is going to be on a bit of a tear to try and prove something. Give me Notre Dame.
Oklahoma at Auburn. Oklahoma favored by 2.5.
Weird seeing Oklahoma without an offense. Auburn down bad tremendously. Give me Oklahoma.
Wisconsin at USC. USC by 15.5.
The air raid Luke Fickle experiment at Wisconsin hasn't been going great so far. USC dropped their first Big Ten matchup to a very underwhelming Michigan team. I think they really got something to prove. But Lincoln Riley, I don't necessarily trust him that much. God, this is a rock and a hard place of who I hate less. Give me USC.
Minnesota at Michigan. Michigan 9.5.
Yucky. Minnesota hasn't been doing great. The boat rowing has not been going that well either. But Michigan is just ugly, but I think they got better players. You know what? Give me Minnesota to be frisky and cover, but they're still going to lose.
Ohio State at Michigan State. 7:30 primetime on Peacock.
Ah, the cock.
Ohio State favored by 24.5.
Give me Ohio State to cover comfortably.
Georgia at Bama. Georgia by 1.5.
Ooh, this is going to be a good one. I want to watch this one. Bama.
And would you like to guess what the Massillon spread is?
I don't know what to make of this DeMatha team, to be honest. They got the dudes, they got the horses, but Massillon minus 1.5.
Massillon by 3.5.
Really? I like it. Okay. Yeah, give me Massillon.
I would say if anything, the spreads that I see usually like give Massillon a little benefit of the doubt, mm-hmm. because a lot of people pick Massillon, you know, not more than they should, but more than like what the 50-50 ratio of what a spread should be.
So more than,
you know, yeah, if you're
more than the
if you're trying to
detach like betting, just it's not.
Yeah, so like last week, some of the media had us as 14-point dogs.
Holy shit.
The Cleveland reflog thing, they had us as 7.5-point dogs.
Oh, to Eds. Yeah.
To Eds. Yeah. And I think this one had us as like 3-point dogs.
I think.
So it's always a little biased towards Massillon.
Yeah. I think.
But so it's giving us 3, or we're covering 3.5.
Okay. So I think. Hasn't it been 3 years in a row that not only have we beaten Eds outright, but we were like going into that as 7-point dogs, right thereabouts?
Potential.
Because
maybe
I think so. I remember last year, like quoting the reflog tweet with that and saying like hammer Massillon. But I mean, I can see the shift in the line a couple points just based on the public, you know, how the public takes them. I like Massillon. I like Massillon minus 1.5. I think I even like a minus 3.5.
Yeah. I like that too.
All right. So with that, hope everybody gets on out there Friday. Get loud, get rowdy. Give these Maryland boys a show of their lifetime. So with that, go Tigers. Beat the Matha.
Go Tigers.